1010 WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Hello, hello, hello. Every Friday here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson.
Good morning once again, Baltimore and beyond. I am Tehma Smith-Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. Some of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell a property, create or update your will or deed, or to purchase your ground rent, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation but you're not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or your comment to 667-334-7242. And last but not least, if you've missed a broadcast, please feel free to check us out on YouTube. Simply go there, type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up where you can listen to it on your phone, your computer, or your television, and you can share it with others.
All righty. And our other co-host, attorney Robert Bob, I call him the Dean. Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. Glad to be with you another Friday morning, particularly after a Ravens win.
Yay!
I was present, 34-20.
I was getting a little nervous there for a while,
Wonders never cease.
Yes, sir.
410-547-8820. If you have business with the city, state, or federal government, particularly in the city, if you need to get paid, which is a circumstance that I'm faced with most often, thank you.
Yeah, and he does pick up the checks. So if you want to get a check too, get in touch with Robert Bob Dashiell. Yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody needs some insurance, or you may want to increase what you got. Okay? Before we have a special guest with us, before we have Tehma introduce him, I do have another person on the line. Is this William Bill Newman?
Yes, it is. How are you, sir?
How are you, sir?
Oh, I'm wonderful.
Great. Tell us about the drive you got going for our listening audience.
Okay, first of all, my name is William Newman. I'm the executive director of the Inner City Suburban Youth Foundation, Inc. We established ourselves in 1999, and what we do is we provide scholarships, educational field trips, mentoring, tutoring to inner city and suburban students between the ages of 6 to 17, as long as they maintain good attendance, good conduct, at least to be average, they remain eligible for our programs until they're 17 years of age. We currently have a coat drive that started on the 7th of this month, and it'll be over probably around maybe the 22nd of next week, where we are donating coats to children between the ages of 4 to 18. And we distributed about over 90 coats so far to inner city and suburban students. Yes, girls as well as boys.
All right. And tell our listening audience how they can get the coats to you, how they can reach you, all that.
Okay. Our phone number is, we can be reached at 443-742-2974, or they can email us at citysubfo@hotmail.com.
Okay, say that again, because you kind of broke up on my end on that one.
Okay, they can email us at citysubfo@hotmail.com.
Okay, we appreciate you, Bill. Give that telephone number one more time, and then we going on.
Okay, it's 443-742-2974. We could use all the help we could get.
Okay. Thank you, Bill. And thank you for all the great work you do for the young people out there in the community, because I've been knowing Bill a long time. Okay. Now, listen, Marvin and Gloria, y'all hang. We have a special guest. If anybody else wants to call in, fine. The number to call is 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. But as usual, we have a special guest with us who's got some viable information. As Kathy Hughes always say, information is power. Okay, Tehma.
Good morning once again, Baltimore and beyond. Today we have with us Mr. Ryan Coleman. Mr. Ryan Coleman was born in Baltimore City. He attended Baltimore City College for high school and then the University of Maryland before receiving his BS from Towson University in business and marketing. He later received his master's in professional studies in public policy from Towson University, and then he attended Purdue University for law school. He has worked and interned for Governor Schaefer and Congressman Ruppersberg. He has been involved with many organizations, which includes the Baltimore City Alumni Chapter, CCBC Board, Baltimore County PTA, and many other groups. He is currently the president of the Randallstown Chapter of the NAACP. Good morning, Mr. Coleman. How are you doing today?
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you for having me. It's a glorious morning today.
Most people know you from being the president of the Randallstown Chapter of the NAACP, and you've been very vocal in regards to juvenile justice and public safety, economics, and education as it relates to the African-American community. Before we get involved or discuss those issues, can you tell us a little bit about the Randallstown NAACP chapter?
Absolutely. So, a lot of people get confused because it's called the Randallstown NAACP, but we are definitely a full-fledged branch, and we have members throughout Baltimore County. And so we tackle all different issues throughout Baltimore County. And another one of our focuses obviously is regionalism, how we interact, obviously, with the city and other counties as well. So we look to push forward a unified unity in Central Maryland. Definitely we need more freedom fighters. If you're interested, please come on down.
And do you have to be a resident of Randallstown? Because I know there is a Baltimore County chapter. So what's the difference and what determines whether or not you can do Baltimore County or Randallstown?
So you can actually be a member of both.
Okay.
You either have to live in the county, Baltimore County, or work in Baltimore County. So we do have some people that just work in Baltimore County who are members as well. The unique thing is that we have a Randallstown chapter and a Baltimore County chapter. This is not unique. Some other areas do have two chapters as well. But we have so many issues in Baltimore County that we can use two chapters.
And I know juvenile justice and public safety is one of the issues that you've been talking about a lot in the media. How has that, or how is that playing out in Baltimore County versus, you know, what you see in Baltimore City? Because I know you've discussed issues when it comes to public safety in Baltimore City as well. What is your take on the difference between the issues in Baltimore County and the issues in Baltimore City when it comes to juvenile justice and public safety?
Right. So, because it's a state issue, the juvenile justice issue crosses jurisdictional lines. And so we're having the same issues that are having in Baltimore City, we're having in Baltimore County. As far as juveniles are concerned, the main two issues are a lack of accountability, but also a lack of resources. The juvenile justice issue really hits home for me because everyone wants to make sure that these juveniles are not held accountable, but they're not given the resources. And so we need to really make sure that these juveniles are held accountable, but they get the resources that is needed to turn them on the right path. That's the whole purpose of DJS. And I do not believe, and the chapter doesn't believe, that this is happening. What's really happening is juveniles are allowed to continue to victimize residents, whether it's in the county or the city. And people in my community are tired of it. They're tired of their cars getting stolen. They're tired of their catalytic converters being stolen. And they want something to be done. So we've been very vocal on, we don't want to throw the key away with these juveniles. We want them to be held accountable, but we also want them to receive the resources that they need. Probably about 3 weeks ago, we had a juvenile, 15, who stole a car in Perry Hall. He was released to his parents that morning. He stole another car in Woodlawn that evening. Mm. And this is the trend that we continue to see with the juveniles not being remanded by DGS and not getting resources.
Let me ask a couple of questions. Well, on one hand, you might say that that's good. You got, at least you got one juvenile, not two doing separate things. So, but on this issue of accountability, and I know that's the politically correct thing to say these days. But isn't it true that the reason that most of these kids are returned to their home is because there's no place to put them? The juvenile detention centers are either not have been closed down or they're already overcrowded. So what are you going to do with them?
Well, what we've seen is that they have room for placement. I don't think placement is the only thing, but home monitoring is another option.
You mean the ankle bracelets?
Yes.
The ones they ignore?
Right. Well,
right, but here's the thing that I see. Like, even if you don't have a placement, you can have ankle bracelets. Give them the resources they need to effectively monitor the ankle bracelets. Yeah, they have ankle bracelets, but if you can go out your house 10 o'clock, 8 o'clock at night, go, you know, to the county. With the bracelet on, and no one says anything or does anything or tap you to come back home, then, you know, there is no accountability. So
that's a reason for that.
Give money, give the resources so you can have a more effective ankle monitoring system if you don't have placement.
The ankle monitoring, let me just tell you why the ankle monitoring system doesn't work for any age, juvenile others, is because the people that they're doing the monitoring are private companies, and they don't get paid if they turn people in, if they violate them. They get $300 a month for so-called monitoring the people on home detention.
Oh, some private companies.
Yes. And so what happens is, what happens if you go somewhere and they violate you and then they lock you up? That $300 a month stops.
Change that part.
Yeah, that's yeah. Like that.
You know, yeah. I mean, if everyone knows what the issues are and why this is happening, why this isn't happening, make the
appropriate adjustments. Because I didn't know this was a private company that was doing this thing.
Yeah, these are the companies that provide monitoring. I think there's only two, actually. It's a big business. I mean, it's a moneymaker.
Right.
Because you don't need anybody even to monitor the computer that's supposed to be providing the monitoring. But it's $300 a month every month. But you only collect it if the people are still on the street. Once you lock them up, nobody's paying the monitoring fee anymore because there's nobody to monitor.
Wow.
Yeah, I think the point is, like you said, why are these things changed? Because we keep seeing them. And for me, all I keep seeing is you know, young black children not getting the resources that they need. The families aren't getting the parenting classes that they need, the mental health services that they need. And so we're asking them to do that. And not every juvenile needs to be in a residential facility.
Right.
It's different ways levels. You can hold them accountable. But what we're seeing is they're not being held accountable at all in any way. They're just returned to their parents and they continue to victimize people. And why this is so important is we don't want them to get into the adult system. We want to give them help. And that's not happening. And my concern is everyone else is getting paid off the backs of these juveniles, but they're not doing their job.
But you know, there is two things. There has always been the ability of those in law enforcement and the state's attorney's office to file petitions to have juveniles declared delinquent. If there's a finding of delinquency, there is the opportunity for a judge to impose a period of I don't want to call it incarceration, but custodial oversight, if you will. I've talked to some state's attorney's office who don't even pursue that because they're too busy doing other things. But when you talk about resources, for example, I wanted to bring something to your attention. There's, the opiate crisis had a particularly devastating impact upon youth, and particularly upon black youth. And one of the problems, of course, is there's no beds available. There's a company that I'm familiar with that proposed to construct, which have been the only black-owned facility of its kind in the state, a 16-bed facility because of the overcrowding in existing. And you know who opposed it? The great Shepherd Pratt. Shepherd Pratt came before the state and said that the creation of the 16-bed facility would put them financially at risk.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Most people can't even afford to go to Shepherd Pratt.
And they got no beds anyway. And we're shipping our kids all across the country, to Texas and all around the country. And so, I agree. Certainly, the resources are necessary. But the big question is, who to provide the resources to? I mean, what group of parents is out there? Anyway, I'll stop. Go ahead, Tim. Or... somebody.
Well, Tim, you got.
No, it's a conversation. So
okay. Anybody send you anything on you? Okay. I kind of want to. Well, let me ask you this before I turn it to another subject. Because first of all, it's my pleasure to meet you. I've been watching you on TV, and let's be very open here. I am a member of the executive committee of Baltimore City Branch. So, Mr. Ryan and I have something in common as far as the NAACP is concerned. Has the state or the Randallstown branch taken any kind of position on how juvenile crime should be handled? And I'm not just talking about in Baltimore County or in Randallstown. I'm talking about statewide. I mean, every state's attorney in the state of Maryland has said there's a problem and it needs to be dealt with. It has been called for a special session, which for some reason the governor doesn't seem to want to have. But is there a state position from the state NAACP or the Baltimore County or the Randallstown or anybody, any NAACP, as far as what they feel should happen concerning juvenile crime? Then I want to get to some other stuff.
Yeah, so I'm not sure about the state. I have not seen anything from the state.
Mm-hmm.
I know that our chapter, we have taken a position on a whole comprehensive plan on how to address juvenile justice, the issues. Obviously, we start first with education and making sure that, because a lot of these children, they're supposed to be in school, but they're out at 2 a.m., you know, stealing cars. And so we look at the schoolhouse as a way, number one, to identify the children who are having problems, but also to show these children what a civilized society should be. And also, obviously, they need opportunity and they need skills. And so we focus on education. We then go into some of the structural racism issues that are plaguing us and how to kind of turn that around as well. And then we dive into the actual juvenile justice, and we kind of laid out, hey, the first time a youth comes in contact with the police, that 1, 2, and 3 should happen as far as resources. There needs to be, the assessment needs to be done properly, where we figure out, hey, do they need mentoring classes? Do they need mental health services? Do they need whatever they need, that after that first incident with the police, that those things are given? Do the parents need parenting classes, and to go into that? The second time, if they steal a car, the same things happen, and then we go into, we want some type of accountability. Maybe that's home monitoring. Maybe that's doing work somewhere, but some type of accountability on the second time. The third time something happened, we wanted something else to happen, whether it's home monitoring or placement. And we just continue to go down the list, because it's really about getting them the resources that they need and not letting them to continue, because they have to be shown that what they're doing is wrong. And what's happening right now is they have no sense of that. So we've taken a position on those things as far as your question.
There was a poll recently released on the Gonzalez poll that stated that 62 of black Democrats in Maryland supported tougher penalties for juvenile offenders. By contrast, 62 of white Democrats in the state supported more lenient penalties for juvenile offenders.
62%, right?
62.
Percent, though.
Percent,
yes. Yeah, okay. You just said 62.
Yeah, right. 62%. Okay. And so the conclusion that Gonzalez made from the polls were that blacks were aligning more with the Republican Party than they were the Democrat Party. So how does the NAACP verbalize or make a statement that is not a Republican or Democratic issue, that we want more tougher penalties mm-hmm. for our juveniles, regardless of what party is in control and what parties are passing laws? And how do you get the Democratic Party as a whole to institute tougher penalties for African-Americans to be held accountable, juveniles?
So I actually saw that poll, too. So we actually did a poll ourselves as well. And it was so many people applying to our poll that the poll got shut down. We had over 700 people, and we had different questions. On the question of stricter laws for juveniles, 90% of the poll wanted stricter laws. This really isn't about Democrat, Republican, Independent, whatever have you. What we try to do at the Randallstown branch is we try to amplify the voices of our community. And we try not to get involved in the politics of it. So we try to stay out of the agenda of the Republicans and so on and so forth. It's really clear, though, our people want something done. They're tired of being victimized. And I hear it all the time. People call me all the time. I'm scared to come out my house. And this is in Baltimore County. I'm scared to come out my house. These juveniles, we don't come out. And so we try to amplify those voices, and we let whatever the facts are handle themselves and try to stay out of the parties. We certainly work not only with Democrats, but we try to work with the Republicans as well. One of our main goals is, obviously, we want the juveniles to get the services so they turn their lives around. And so we just stick to the facts of what we're trying to do, and we don't get involved necessarily with the politics of it. But at times it can be hard.
When it comes to the educational aspects of African Americans in the county and the city, what do you think needs to be changed or improved in the educational arena to help benefit not just the juveniles, but the family system as well?
We really believe that there needs to be educational options. What is happening is that our children, it's like our children are the new cotton. You get a per pupil allocation for them, but you don't have to educate them. And we continue to see this. We have schools where no student passed the math assessment, zero. We have in the county, 7th and 8th graders, only 5% of them are proficient in math. Now, I don't know about everybody else, but if my dentist could only fill my cavity 5% of the time, I'd be finding another dentist. So this is a crisis where our black children are not being educated. And so we're looking for education options, charter schools, magnet schools, private schools. At this point, I don't care what it is, but I don't want people to be locked in a school, to be sequestered in a school, to be held hostage in a failing school. And it's very difficult for African Americans to be educated. And I know this with my own family, trying to get them into the right school, trying to make sure they have the right skills so that they can be successful in college or trade school or wherever they want to go.
So let me ask you, do you favor vouchers? Is that what you're saying or what?
I think that's something that we have to look at. I think that's something that we have to look at. There are a lot of people against vouchers because they think it hurts public education. And so I think we have to look at the BOOST program, for instance.
How do you feel about the BOOST program? Mm-hmm. That was cut. It was trying to be eliminated. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, that's educational options for kids in the county, in the city, and throughout the state of Maryland.
We got so many. When the BOOST program was about to be eliminated, we got so many calls against that. Because most of the students in the BOOST program are African-American or Hispanic mm-hmm. in Baltimore City and Baltimore County. So people are utilizing that program. And again, I think we have to look at all options. Obviously, we want a strong public education system. We're not trying to get rid of the public education system, but I think we have to be realistic that it's not working for a lot of people.
But it's not the building, it's the people. It's the relationship that the teachers have. You know,
absolutely.
I come from a small town with everybody was black in my class. It was before the so-called integration took place. If you don't have teachers who believe the kids can learn,
yep.
who understand that in order to engage them in the process, you first have to reach their hearts before you can talk to their minds. If you don't have that framework, you can have a BOOST program, a loose program, or no program. It's all about relationship, to borrow from Tehma's father. It's all about relationship, or it ain't about nothing. So the real problem is finding the right match between training on the part of the teachers, discipline on the part of the system. We've taken away, in my opinion, tools from parents to discipline their own kids.
And teachers.
So we've taken away tools that they need. You know, the school, when I came up, the school was an extension of your home.
Yep.
Right? But we've abandoned that notion for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. We've now turned over education to a matter of statistics, to the pencil pushers. How many passed, how many didn't pass. Instead of focusing on the relationship that's necessary to, I had a guidance counselor when I was in, who told me that I would do well if I was good in automotive mechanics. Now because when my car's broken down, I don't go to lawyers. I go to automotive. but she told me I'd be well. She had no idea, you know, what that meant to me. Of course, she called me back when she said, "Oh, maybe you had good grades. Maybe you can go to college." But so yep. that relationship yep. that my anger at her is what caused me to go forward. Relationship, it's all about relationship, it ain't about nothing. So when people say public school, private school, charter school, they're really avoiding the real issue. The real issue is the relationship between the teacher and that student, and what do you need to make that thing positive?
But maybe that's not the real issue, because the teachers who are quitting the system, they're not quitting because of necessarily the relationship that they have with their students. But a lot of times they feel that their hands are tied. I can't teach the students. Not that I don't think that they can learn, but the system is designed that I can't effectively teach them based on this curriculum that they want me to teach, or this that they want me to learn. You know, every thing in a public system isn't a one size fit all, but in this classroom, this is what I have to do under the system. So it doesn't allow the teachers to effectively teach their students. So it's not necessarily the relationship on a teacher's level. It might be on a systematic level mm-hmm. where people or parents might say, well, I don't want to be in this public school system. Maybe another system, whether it's charter or private, where the teachers have more flexibility to interact with the students and build that relationship, is better suited for my child.
But the system system is not a living being. If there are people in positions that are impacting negatively on the teacher's ability to form that relationship, and I agree that, but then we need to move those people. We keep talking about a system as though it has the government as the government is people. If the system isn't working, that means the people who are in positions of authority to operate the system aren't working.
But a lot of times it's easier to move your child than to move the people
in
the system.
Well, that's that. You know, I call that kicking the can down the road. And my problem is we're at the edge of the cliff now. We're either going to stand and fight or jump. And I ain't a jumper.
And I would agree with you. When I look at these different schools, that, you know, my daughter went to Carver A&T in Towson. And you can look at the schools that are achieving and you look at the schools that aren't, okay? And one of the things you have is you have a principal and teachers who have been there a long time.
Yes, yes,
okay?
Yes.
You have a system at that school, because really at Carver, it didn't matter what was going on at Greenwood or anywhere else. You have an expectation of accountability that these students are going to be educated, which is not at other schools happening like that. And so, you know, the main thing, the issue that we see specifically in Baltimore County is, and this is nothing against newer teachers, they're just not as veteran as veteran teachers, that in a lot of the black schools, they're new principals and they're new teachers.
And high turnover, that's
and
right.
And high turnover.
That's right.
And that continues to happen. So the ability for that school, because it's not just one person at a school,
right.
It's a lot of parts why schools are, why our schools in these areas are not working. And so we need to look at those and delve into those. But I still think that educational options is the quickest way to give people the ability to go out. And then we need to come back and certainly try to fix all of our schools. But at least some students are being saved while we're doing that. And it's really important that we give these kids not only the discipline, but the opportunity. And I know when I was at City College, these teachers were pulling that out of you. And now all I hear now is, well, we need mentorship programs. And I'm thinking to myself, well, what are these teachers doing? Where's Miss Alfred from second grade when I went to Canfield Elementary that would pull me in and do these different things and look out after me? I don't necessarily see that. And we need to get back to that.
And also when it comes to education, the accountability isn't there. You know, if a student isn't doing well, you need to have the option of failing them, sending them back, making sure they master before they move on to a second grade. And a lot of times that option isn't there. You say, okay, he's failing, but we'll give him a D just so that he can progress. And before we open the phone lines and talk about the issues that we previously discussed, what about economics for the African-American community? What do you think will improve the middle class or people living on borderline poverty? What type of economics do you think should be available to them?
So contrary to what most people believe, the black middle class in Baltimore County is growing. Okay. We get these narratives that it's not. However, we do need to really look at politics and positions that help the middle class, because the middle class is really what pushes your county or the country forward, okay? And we have tried different things to advocate, you know, better dental insurance. That's something that middle-class people always got to deal with. Every time I go to the dentist, I'm always paying something. So we want to look at these different policies on how we can help the actual middle class. Raising the minimum wage is not helping the middle class, per se, okay? So we need to figure out different policies that can help propel middle class people. They're struggling right now. And groceries cost a lot. A lot of different things. Car insurance is going up, which is a byproduct of all these cars being stolen. Okay. I have members who can't even really get help, car insurance for their Kia because it's so much now that they can't even get insurance for that. And so the other piece of this, though, is the quality of life issues and bringing stores into black communities so that we can have the same quality of life as anyone else. And that's been a big focus on, we don't want all these dollar stores. We don't want all these chicken joints. We don't want all these stores that they're trying to push down on us. We want the coffee shops. We want the bookstores. We want the sit-down restaurants. We want the nice jazz restaurants. We want the grocery stores, because on Liberty Road, there's a food desert in parts. And so we want these different things. And looking at Liberty Road, the medium income is above the state average. But if you drive down Liberty Road, you might think that's not true. And so the stores that they're giving us in different areas do not reflect the people that live around those areas. And those are what we're trying to address and attack.
Okay, WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. What that means, if you can't hear us too well on the radio, you can go on the internet and pull us up. If you want to call in, because we're going to go to the phones, the number to call is 410-481-1010. That's 410-481-1010. And our special guest today is Mr. Ryan Coleman, the president of the Randallstown chapter of the NAACP. And we're coming to the phones in this order. Gloyd, wait a minute, Marvin, Gloyd, D, Carlos, and Mark. And once one of them get off, you could call in at the same time. But before we come to the phones, I just want to change the subject just a little bit. But next year is a very important election year, not just for the city of Baltimore, but for the nation. In my opinion, it's going to be the make-or-break election on whether we are going to still be a democracy in this country or we're going to be taken over by a dictatorship. What is the Randallstown branch, the state branch, the national branch, what are they doing to get people registered to vote? Because there's a whole slew of people out there, especially young people. I don't think young people understand how important this election is coming up next year. Of course, they have come out for the midterm, which surprised a lot of people, and saved some things. But what is going on with your chapter or whatever chapter to get people registered?
I'll speak to my chapter.
And then I'm coming to the phone.
I'll speak to my chapter specifically. To your point, that's the whole point. Not only getting people registered, but also giving them information to make educated decisions. And we at every event, we try to register people and we tell people a lot of, you know, when you're looking down that ballot, it's a whole lot of judges and other things that you vote for that are very important as well as the top of the ticket. Okay. And so we need to have the information and make our choice. Now, we don't try to tell people what choice they make. We try to put the information out there,
right,
so that they make informed decisions. And voting is important. But the other thing we try to do is we try to show the power of working together and what can be done. There's so many people who I hear all the time, well, it's not going to matter if I vote. It's not going to matter. It all stays the same. It don't matter. It's all, you know, whether it's a Dem in there, Republican in there, it's all bad, period. And so we try to show the power that you have. County Executive Johnny Olszewski, he won by about 50-some votes. 50-something.
When he first ran, won by 6 votes.
So your vote counts. And so we try to illustrate those different things and reach out to young people, but also older people who think it's not important, because it is so important, because we need people to vote so that we can make sure that the issues that affect Black folks are taken into consideration and that we're at the table.
Do you have any programs that encourage people to participate by running for office? I postulate perhaps something that is not particularly popular, but one of the reasons why I suspect some people may say there's no need because they don't feel they have adequate choices. I mean, the notion that your choice is limited necessarily to a Democrat or a Republican, mm-hmm. I think is an inhibiting factor. And I think that that organizations, particularly within our community, within the Black community, need to focus on participation in the electoral process is two-pronged, not just one. It's not just voting, but it's also running for office. So do you have programs designed to help create and nurture people who may seek leadership positions in the political environment?
That's a great point. We do not currently have anything that addresses that, although we have had conversations about that. Mm. And looking at folks who have run, looking at folks who are out there, who seem to be on the line of really wanting to try to do something for our folks. And you're absolutely right. We have to try to cultivate some of those people. The conversations that I've had is with some of the elected folk who are a little older, because we need younger people to come through at some point. And we have to groom them and get them ready. And those are the discussions. And there have been some discussions on trying to create some programs like that to help folk get ready, because you need to be ready. Because just because you're elected doesn't mean you know what you're doing.
Right. Okay. When I come to the lines here, if you got a question for Mr. Coleman, get it in. I don't need an essay. If you got a question for Mr. Coleman, let's get right into it and move on. I got a full board here. So let's start with Marvin. You on air.
Hey, Carl. How y'all doing this morning?
All right.
Hey, Carl. I had something on this morning when I was talking about conversation. I wouldn't be able to cross that over to you a little bit, would I?
Well, first of all, do you have a question? Wait a minute, hold it. Do you have a question for Mr. Coleman?
Not really.
Okay, then let me put you on hold. We'll get back to you.
Okay.
Let me put you on hold. Okay?
All right.
All right.
All right.
Okay. Next one.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Let's go to next is Gloyd. Gloyd, you got a question for Mr. Coleman? Gloyd?
Yes.
You got a question for Mr. Coleman?
Oh, yeah, of course, of course.
Go ahead.
Your voice is coming in kind of low.
Go ahead.
Hello? Oh, yeah. I'm a community person, and I'm concerned about our young people, and I'm against, and I hear people talk all the time, locking them up, putting them in jail, throw the key, give them more time. No, what needs to be done?
Wait, hold it. You got a question for him. We don't have time for an essay.
Well, I'm an elderly person. Give me a chance.
I understand that, but I got a full board here, Gloria, and we're up against the time.
All right, forget it. Forget it, because I can't be fast as a lot.
No, I'm not asking you to be faster, but if you got a question for him, go ahead and ask the question, and he can answer it, and I can go on.
Well, yeah, it's probably going to come out in the wash, but the question, all right, I can't, holding on so long, I just can't get it out right now. But my concern is, I'll ask him this, does he think to have a facility available like Rosewood, Spring Grove, and put kids there and teach them all, teach them what they need to know until they become, until they can be developed, because that's what's going on now, because these young people don't have skills and everything. So,
okay. Now, before you answer, because there's an interesting article on the front page of The Sun today, where 25 people alleged sex abuse at Cheltenham Detention Center. Now, I remember coming up when the two basic centers for juvenile males that were in trouble was Boys Village, mm-mm, and Cheltenham.
Mm-hmm.
Now you got grown men who have went through that system back when they were 13, 14 years old are coming out now alleged sexual abuse. And I bring that up now because Gloyd brought up a very good point about opening centers like this. Now, and okay, fine. When we open these centers, how we know who we are stocking, the people that we are stocking it with, are these the real people that we really want to be in there? Go ahead.
Yeah, no, to his question, absolutely. I think we need to have residential facilities for certain things. I mean, unless that's not the first option that we go to, unless it's a public safety issue, but that's not the first option. But to your point, we need a lot of the two facilities you talked about were understaffed, and those folks weren't trained appropriately.
Right.
And so we need to make sure that they're staffed appropriately. And train,
right.
Okay.
Along with the hickey. I forgot to bring
them in. Along with hickey.
Yep. Yeah.
And so that needs what we need to do. And the focus of, again, DJ Guest, is to make sure that these kids get on the right path. And so we need to make sure that if they go into a residential facility, that they get the resources. Because going into a residential facility, a lot of times people say it doesn't work. Well, yeah, it doesn't work because they still don't get the resources that they need.
Right.
And so they got to get the resources wherever they are. They got to get the resources.
Right. D, you have a question for Mr. Coleman.
I'm like the other gentleman. I still, you know, we've been holding on for quite a while. And to ask a question and put out a statement, it doesn't make sense.
No. Listen, hold it.
Okay.
If you have a question, you should have had it in your mind or written it down.
I have a couple questions.
Okay, now I'm going to open it up. I'm going to allow you to ask the couple questions, Mr. Coleman, so he can answer and I can go down the board. Thank you.
Okay, first of all, I have a question as to who, have you ever worked in a facility before? And where is this information coming from in regards to what the DJF give or the resources they receive, the supervision that's in the system? Have we worked specifically in these facilities to be able to make that judgment? I've worked for juvenile service for over 30 years. I've worked in all the institutions and all. It is a lot of training. You get training. You have to have background fingerprinting and everything. So people working in those facilities are trained properly. And also, I would say this, in regards to those kids who are, we're talking about, because we throw out a lot of things, but we really don't have the experience or expertise to really know what really goes on and how things are done. And also,
What's your second question?
That's what I'm going to get right now.
Okay. All right, go ahead.
Because we need to stop judging these young people and African Americans. Oh, but my second question is, if he did work in these facilities or programs or have background on this information, then you would know that the juvenile is the do you know that the juvenile system cannot do anything? You have all these things A, B, and C that you all like to see, but the thing is, unless a child has been adjudicated in court, those services are not being met. We need to look. Are we looking at the family? I never heard Tim say at all. We need to look at the family first, because a lot of things going on starts in the home. No one said that, but we continue to blame the system.
Okay, Mr. Coleman. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, thank you for that question. That's a good point. Obviously, we need to give resources to parents. But however, DJS mission, the whole mission of DJS is to ensure that our young people are put on the right path. And so when we're talking about training, we're not saying everyone needs training. He asked a direct question on some of this sexual abuse. But I have done, actually for over maybe 10 years, I was Dutch Ruppersberger's main person, legislative person on juvenile justice issues. And so I visited a lot of these different facilities. I was probably a month ago, I was at the Baltimore County Detention Center, seeing how those children were engaged and what their environment was, and also had the pleasure of seeing how they were getting educated at the Baltimore County Detention Center. And so, you know, when we say a lot of these things, as far as what I do is I try to do my homework and go in and figure out and to see for myself what is going on. But it's very clear, and this isn't to get on anybody, but it's very clear that the services and the resources are not being given to the youth. Okay, all you have to do is look at the recidivism rate. Okay, it's just not there.
Brother Carlos, you got a question for Mr. Coleman?
No, I'll just hold on, please.
Okay, let's go to Mark. Mark, you got a question for Mr. Coleman?
Yeah, how y'all doing? And thanks for having him on. Yeah, can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, thanks for having him on. Mr. Coleman, thanks for everything that you're doing. A lot of people don't know that you're an educator. Also, I got two questions. Number one, when you talk about the resources for the young people and stuff like that, the state's attorney, a big part of his thing is citation. Court where you can go for treatment and kids and all that kind of stuff. So when people say, you know, just lock them up, they don't talk about that part. Second thing is, in Baltimore City, we got $200 million on and on and on that they pretty much don't know what to do with. you know, what do you think that we can do right now, you know, leadership-wise, to kind of turn this ship around?
Thank you, Mark.
Hey, yeah, thanks, Mark. Good to hear from you again. I think we have to hold our elected officials accountable, and I think we have to hold the different agencies accountable. I think that, you know, when we watch the Ravens game, if they're not able to score a touchdown, I mean, people are losing their mind on the problems with the offense. But we continue to have juveniles not getting resources, repeat offenders running around, and the same recurring issues happening, and it doesn't seem any urgency or any solutions are about. So we need to hold our elected officials accountable.
I have a text from Mr. Melvin. It says, a strategy needs to be developed to help juveniles get tutoring to learn to read and write. They must be able to read an application and fill it out. The big dilemma is getting them to overcome stigma of admitting that they can't read or write. If 70% of teachers are white, our people must look to alternative solutions to this crisis. Also, why can't we convince an all African-American school board to bring back industrial trades? So how do we get more African-Americans in the classroom so that our students can have someone that they can relate to? And how do we get more trades so our students can have options?
Absolutely. I agree with that. We have in Baltimore County, we have about 11% African-American teachers. This is not to say, because I hear this all the time, that I think white teachers cannot teach. This is not to say that. But we feel that it needs to be diversity in the teaching ranks. And that I think with black children, seeing teachers that are the same as them, it's important. And I think it's very important. As far as trades is concerned, this is the biggest thing that gets on my nerves with this. We are not pushing kids through trade schools appropriately. In Baltimore County, it's an issue. And now in a lot of other places, it's an issue. People can make good money. And we have to make sure that our children have those type of opportunities. Whether it's going, everybody can't go to college. So going to college or trade school. But over and again, having students that cannot read and write being promoted year over year is an issue. And we have to change that.
Marvin, you're on air. You have a question for Mr. Coleman.
I wanted to say something about what I had said this morning to do a little bit of correction on it. That's the only thing I wanted to do.
Oh, no, I can't have you come back now. If you've been on, you know.
No, I was on, but I don't have a question for him, though.
You had put him on hold. You had put him on hold.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was on hold.
Oh, you was on hold? Okay, let me put you back on hold. Yeah. Let me go to Alan. Call back, Marvin. You got cut off. Alan.
Carlton. Yeah, Carlton. And to the guest, Mr. Coleman. You with the Randallstown NAACP, am I right?
Yes, sir. How are you calling?
This is Alan.
Alan. How you doing?
My cousin is independent in Gary now. He's a Gary chapter of the NAACP. And I said, you're a young boy, too. He called us little brat. He called black guys brat. I said, I listened to him. That you know what? You had to put back in the house before you put an assistant from the government, the black man, back in the house.
Hey, do you have a question, Alan?
That's what I'm saying. Do you believe in bringing in the National Guard for kids? I'm hitting the buzzword. I mean, you can't get by me. Do you believe that the NAACP endorsed putting the National Guards to deal with our kids? They're under 18 years old.
No, I don't think I ever said that one. I think I will say this, though. I think we have to look at all options when we see the level of violence that's happening. A lot of people get hooked on the National Guard. A state of emergency is typically what I have talked about in the past. And what a state of emergency does is open up a lot of money so that you can address some of these issues that we're talking about. I know people want to just focus on the National Guard, but the state of emergency is what I have talked about in the past.
Okay. Rashid, do you have a question for Mr. Coleman?
I don't have a question, but I could be on topic, though.
No. This is a question for Mr. Coleman. We don't have time for a topic and an essay and all that.
Right.
Okay, you don't have a question for him?
No, it was educational at Morgan State yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Maybe.
All right. How long can you stick around, Mr. Coleman?
I was sticking around.
Okay, now we're getting ready to go into our second hour, but we're going to be talking about a whole lot of other things that we might want to get your input on. Let me get to Marvin and see what he might want to have talked about. And Marvin, you're on air. What was it on your mind?
Hey, Carl, just had a brief conversation with the show was on this morning.
Turn your radio down.
Okay. And look, as soon as I got off the phone, my sister called me and told me, she said, "Mom, you know what?" I said, "What?" She said, "Black people don't need to come to the table with white people and discuss a plan about how they're going to get ahead." She said, "Because we was already ahead with Wall Street." I said, "What are you talking about?" She said, "Wall Street was a big-time black business. Right now, to this day, would have been a billion-dollar business if the white man would have left it alone. The white man went in there and robbed us of that business, took it away from us, and told us that he would take care of us for the rest of our life." Now,
that's not really what happened, but go ahead.
But look, right now to the day, look how he's taking care of us. Disrespecting us and doing everything wrong that he could do. He to cause us the way we is today, but yet disrespect us. So you know something, Carlton? Right now, there's a lot more black people than me thinking the same way. It's something called lit sticks of dynamite about to erupt if that don't come back to the table and be changed. That's what I got to say.
Hey, Marvin, before you go,
yeah,
just to clear my mind on what you're talking about, are you talking about the Wall Street in New York, or are you talking about Black Wall Street?
In Tulsa.
Black Wall
in
Street.
Tulsa.
It
okay.
Look, all right.
Got to go.
Alone,
got to go, because we're going in the second hour. Yeah, got to go. Okay. Get ready to go into the second hour of the Frank M. Conway Sr. Ed Al Show. Our special guest today is Mr. Ryan Coleman, president of the Randallstown branch of the NAACP. Don't go anywhere. We can hear you. If you want to call in, the number to call is 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Don't touch that dial. We will be right back. We got a couple lines open. 410-481-1010.
14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many. And you best
talk in the day. Soul at night on the new 1010 WOLB.